Let me take the first poll. I would like everyone here to answer. This is the poll that is asking you to answer yes or no, or were you taking any allopathic medicines in the past, or are you taking any allopathic medicine right now? Do take the poll and answer, and I will be able to see the answers very much right now. Are you taking some allopathic medicine? Yes or no? Or were you taking in the past? Do let me know. Looks like 83% says, 85% says no, and 25%, 22% are saying yes. All right. So looks like already I have a very good audience that's not taking allopathic medicine so much. Only some are already taking and some were taking in the past. Thank you very much for answering. Welcome all. Today's talk is about integrated approach to cancer. I was asking the question about any allopathic medicine, not necessarily only for cancer. So anyway, thank you very much for answering that. I'll be asking some more questions also later on. So basically, let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Rupa Shah. I am an allopathic doctor by degree. I've got MBBS degree. I passed out 37 years ago. I'm a holistic physician. I'm one of the pioneer of Indian flower remedies. This is a very less known healing science yet at the moment. But me and my husband, Dr. Atul Shah, we have been using Indian flower remedies for more than 37 years now. I'm also author of various lifestyle-related books. I have written books on dairy alternatives and also on calcium. That is, what about my calcium? I'm a public speaker and I'm a health educator, and also I am vegan for more than 14 years now. So I'm one of the vegan lifestyle promoter. Before I begin my talk, I would like to mention the disclaimer today. I am a medical doctor with MBBS degree. I am registered in Maharashtra Medical Council. I'm not a trained nutritionist or dietitian or oncologist. The topic today discussed should not be substituted as medical advice. Here, I am doing this talk to increase awareness regarding integrated approach. I do not make any claim to cure cancer or any other diseases, and this does not replace proper medical care. I have learned a lot from various masters across the globe in last 37 years. I traveled to many countries. I met many famous doctors who have written excellent books. I learned a lot, and over the years, I have developed a very unique way of healing, and that I'm going to describe a bit later today. But all I wanted to say that, we never stop learning. Even today, I'm learning. So I would like to name a few. It is right from Dr. Bach, Edward Bach, where I read his books and learned about flower remedies, about homeopathy. I learned from Dr. George Vithulkas. And then later on, I also learned about David Tensley, then Gurudas, then also the books on flower remedies by Richard and Patricia Kaminsky. Later on, there's a very famous book. I'm going to show you the quote from there by Dr. Richard Gerber, then Dr. Deepak Chopra, Dr. Noam Shilley. The list goes on and on. Later on, I read the book China Study. And I also learned from Dr. Nandita Shah about the plant-based diet. Later on, I met Dr. Neil Barnard and learnt about reversing diabetes program. And then finally, recently I met naturopathic Dr. Arun Sharma. So my list goes on, and I have learnt something good from all of these masters, and I have incorporated and I understood things in greater depth as I moved along. So I'm very thankful, gratitude to these masters for teaching me. And there's also one more thing that I learned about 10 years ago from Russian masters, and that's about joyful mind magic technique, that is by the two Russian magicians who teach about the mind magic. So all this, you know, has added me, and I am what I am because of these masters. I have huge gratitude. And if any of you want to know more about them or about their books, I'm happy to share. What made me take this path of integrated medicine? So I have an allopathic degree, and I was a very proper allopathic doctor in the medical college. But as soon as I was in the last year of my medical college, I was also learning a lot about meditation. And I had met a master who taught me about meditation, and I had gone to meet him in England in 84. And there he opened up my world by explaining to me all about mind, emotions, body, and holistic approach. And he told me to travel across England and learn about various complementary therapies. And, you know, then I started learning more about all kinds of different therapies. It could be herbal medicine, Ayurveda, magnetotherapy, acupuncture, acupressure. I just opened my mind and I kept it open to learn what's in the other system. And that completed the picture, and my journey started on a very, very good footing. And just around the time, I also had some health issues, and I was trying to help myself during those difficult times in life when I was quite young. It was just 24, 25, 26, this age. And whatever health problems I faced, I found alternative or complementary therapies helping me tremendously. And that, you know, allowed me to open up and find an approach where we take the best of every system of healing. Every system has something good, and it's the best to have integrated approach. Let's not waste our time criticizing anyone. Let's take something good which is in each system and then move on. And this was my foundation. And that was very fortunate that it started like 37 years ago, where I could look at all the different pathies, see what is good in each, what is the way of diagnosis, what is their understanding, and then pick up the best one and move on. So this is what I have done, and this is my story. And whatever health conditions I had were tremendously better, no side effects, and I moved on to the next level, and I learned some of the foundational principles about what is health, what is disease, what is the correct way of healing, what is the direction of healing, what is the role of karma, how the natural systems also help. All this I learned. My inspiration for today's talk is my friend Charul Shah, who is no more. And a few years ago, I lost her to breast cancer. And that has been my very big inspiration, that how this happened. I learned a lot about cancer right from her. So my talk today is dedicated to Charul Shah. Me and my husband, Dr. Atul Shah, over the years have treated all kinds of patients who came to us. It was any diagnosis. And most of the time we get patients who have been everywhere, who have done everything. Probably they have done their radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and you know, the surgery is done, and now probably the cancer is spreaded everywhere, and it's the last stage, and that's when they start looking for doctors like us if there's anything, you know, that you can offer. So that was fine, and whatever cases came along, we had no idea whether we can help them or not. But I said, let's start, let's do something, whatever we know. So right in the beginning, there was a case that had chronic myeloid leukemia and was in one of the famous hospitals in Mumbai. and was in the last stage, almost, you know, breathing last. And doctors had given up and said that maybe 2-3 hours left, you know, and that's it, called all the relatives and informed. The patient was in the hospital. I don't think we are allowed to even treat such patient. But patient's relative said, just do drop whatever you can. We don't know. Doctors have already given up on him. And whatever natural remedies, you know, that time we knew, we gave. And it was a overwhelming surprise that within few hours, the patient became completely conscious. His blood count kept improving in next few days. He became totally normal after that. And he lived well for 2 years after that and died of heart attack later. And we, my husband, myself, we are allopathic doctors. We were shocked to know that what is it that we need to learn from this patient? What is it that we don't know about health, healing, cancer, medication, therapies? What is the mainstream medicine is missing? And how can a patient who was supposed to die, you know, get better? What actually the magic that happened? There was another case that we treated, was a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Again, it was, she was on chemotherapy, her CT scan report showed very advanced stage and was like a gone case. She was elderly lady and very fragile, and the time we were to go to America for a month and we just gave her the remedies and went off. We didn't know what. When we came back, she was still alive. She was supposed to die, not last that long. She was still alive. So in 2 months' time, my husband repeated the CT scan and all the, you know, tumor size, the lymph node sizes had reduced drastically. And after that, she recovered completely and remained well for 10 full years and died of something else. There's another patient of vaginal cancer where it had spreaded and she was put only on radiation because doctor thought that that's the only way out, and she was a very poor patient. And by the time it was a few sittings of radiation and of course our remedies were going on, within, you know, like such a short span, the cancer had completely disappeared, and the radiologist was very surprised. That where is it gone? Who was the patient? Did you have it? Like, you know, it had healed completely at a speed faster than we ever thought or imagined. And doctor knew that radiation cannot do such fast results. There was another patient of breast cancer whom we treated. And it was, she did her chemo, radio, whatever else was required was done. At the same time, we also supported her with natural remedies and recovered completely. There's a patient of brain cancer who had tumors and doctors had given up, and she lived very long, another few years, and then died peacefully. So, and there's a patient of testicular cancer who's still alive, who recovered very fast within few months and had stopped his chemo halfway through because he thought he was well, and he's still alive even now. So these are the stories that are very surprise. It's a, you know, magic. It is not heard of, and we thought we need to learn something from it. Definitely, there's something that is not yet, you know, available to everyone. Let's learn what is it, and that's how our journey began. And these were the patients who inspired us a lot. There's so much I learned over the years by meeting my cancer patients. Patients come, the way they come into the clinic, they sit, they put their files on my table, and then I'm talking to them, and there's so much, you know, there's so much to learn. Sometimes I see a very vacant look in their eyes. I see them staring, very blank, very depressed. The hemoglobin is very less. They are like not sure whether they are alive or they're half dead or they are already living in the other planes of consciousness. And when I see them, I would start want to read the story of their life and understand about them. So over the years, I spent time talking to them. I spent time talking about their life, their history, their relationships, everything that went on in their life, what they thought about their diagnosis, what they thought about death, what they thought about their dear ones. All this, you know, taught me a lot. And I understood that cancer is not just about body, It is also about the emotions. It is also the mind. It's about the way patient relates and understands and, you know, interprets life and the his journey so far. Whatever he has gone through, the trauma, the experiences, all that is part of it. Also his environment, the people with whom he lives, all of it is very important. So this is what I learned, and over the years I've been able to almost predict the story of their life. What I understand that our body never lies. The diseases that happen to us, there's always a story, there's always a reason. Our human body is a transparent machine, and cancer just does not happen just like that. It happens for a reason. There is a proper predictable story, and there's also often predictable story at the emotional level also. And I'm able to touch much deeper, spending time talking to their soul and having a very gentle conversation. And this is one of the most important part of my practice, is to connect with my patient, connect at a deeper level, connect at a soul level, and understand in totality. If you make that connection, then the deepest of the suppressed emotions, experiences, truths, you know, get revealed. And then one can treat the patient much better. As I understood that it's not just about treating the body, it is treating about every aspect of the patient. So the question is, are chronic diseases reversible? Would you like to share in the chat section? Friends, what do you think? Many of the chronic diseases names that you heard about, rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis, SLE, maybe type 1 diabetes, even type 2 diabetes, psoriasis. Are these diseases reversible? What does the modern medicine say? High blood pressure, right? They say it's reversible or not reversible. Looks like I have a very good audience. Sujal, thank you very much for answering. Yes, yes, chronic diseases are also reversible, provided we know, we have the key, we know the exact method, how we have to get going. So the, of course, the proper diagnosis, proper guidance, and always remember, for every disease, we have to know the cause. If you know the cause and you remain aware about the cause, handle the cause, you should be able to reverse all chronic diseases. Stay very focused. And what is the cause of various diseases? Over the years, I come from allopathic background with there are thousands of diagnoses, thousands of diseases, so many different things going on. And we were told that there are this viruses, this bacteria, or causes unknown. So many diseases. We kept studying, we kept, you know, learning about it. But what is the fundamental cause of various diseases? It's very simple, that when our body is preparing an environment or a soil which is suitable for the disease to happen, then only disease can happen. Disease does not happen in a healthy body. If you are fit, if all your functions are fine, if you are emotionally very calm, clear, positive, very spiritually aligned, the diseases will not happen in a healthy body. It always happens when the food is available for a particular bacteria or a virus or a condition to happen. So for every disease, I would put it as having less health is the cause of various diseases. If you're not healthy, you're going to get diseases. So this is the fundamental. You can call it as some toxins in your body or a toxemia, that would do. But this is the cause, something that your body cannot get rid of, then now the disease is going to happen as a part of activity of your own body to want to get rid of it. Our body is very intelligent machine. It has capacity to heal, and disease is part of this healing process. So in what is the definition of cancer? I'm not going to waste too much of time. Just read out two lines and then move on. So cancer is been said in Wikipedia as a group of diseases involving abnormal cell growth with the potential to invade or spread to other parts of the body. And these are different than the benign tumors, which do not spread. Now, cancer cells do not always come as tumors. For example, there is leukemia, whereas cancer cells are in the blood, they are circulating throughout the body. So it's not necessarily always the tumor, but it can also be. So just put it as abnormal cells in the body, which has got abnormal demands and which has got abnormal capacity, abnormal shape and abnormal survival rate. Have you seen this picture anywhere on internet? This is the name of the person, is Andreas Moritz. He used to live in America and he has written the very famous book that is, Cancer is Not a Disease, It's a Survival Mechanism. He has a YouTube channel. He is no more alive now, but he has written fantastic book. This one book is very, very important to understand the foundation of this disease. He says that cancer is not something that comes from outside. It develops inside our own body like a survival mechanism. So for example, I like to explain that a human body, when alive, you have a certain kind of bacteria on your skin, on your surface. But the moment that death happens and you are dead now, it's a corpse, it's a dead body, there is no life in it. The cadaveric bacteria start thriving because now these bacteria know this is our food and they clean up the whole body. If nobody touches that body, within weeks everything is gone except the bones. So the bacteria are there to clean up because their food is available. These are called as cadaveric bacteria. So bacteria or viruses are happen to be seen only when their food is available. So the cancer cells also need certain food to thrive. And that food is, when it is available in our body, when that environment is created in our body, the cells now start becoming abnormal. Because the food is available, the stimulus is there, and as a process to clean up these toxins, the cells get into the survival mode and start cleaning up the toxins, eating up and transforming. So high sugar environment definitely is cancer environment. So any of these, you know, toxins, when they start getting collected beyond a point, the body tries to help. Body tries to clean up. But at, like in a healthy body also, 800 cancer cells are produced every single day. And our body cleans up. Our immune system looks after and everything is clear. But the moment our system breaks down, moment the toxemia is much higher, the cancer cell activity starts happening. So when the tumor happens, it's actually for the time being isolating it from the rest of the body, and it is very organ specific and it limits to that particular organ and keeps doing this activity. Wherever the toxins are maximum accumulated, these cells take birth and they start, you know, eating up and transforming. So this is the process that happens. But the toxemia, if it's too high, the cells will spread across the body and will start also clearing up from other parts of your body. So this is the fundamental understanding about cancer, which is not exactly like how allopathic system is. Their understanding is not exactly like this. They are more into how to clean up the cancer cells, how to kill the cancer cell activity, how to remove the cancer cells by surgery or radiation or by chemotherapy. So now integrated approach is what I have taken on, as for the time being the main system across the globe is of course the allopathic system, and then we have homeopathy, Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha, and these other systems like acupuncture, Chinese medicine, various kinds of healing approaches, Reiki and pranic healing, aromatherapy, and also I do flower remedies and diet and lifestyle. So how about, you know, taking the best of everything and then integrate it, advise properly, and then help the patient. This is what I thought, and this is how I have moved ahead with the integrated approach. So here is the little picture that shows that, you know, all the different systems of healing and is taken as a part of the integrated medicine. the holistic health. Now, how many of you have heard about holistic health? Here, I would just like to ask you, if you have heard, just do let me know. And if you want to answer in the chat section, do let me know if you have heard about holistic health. Otherwise, anyway, I'm going to explain you. So holistic health is about mind, body and soul. Our emotions are also taken into consideration. Every disease also has not just a physical component, but also the emotional and also the mental and also the soul component. And any system of healing that takes into consideration all aspects, they are the one who are aligned to holistic health. However, allopathic system is very focused on the body, on the chemicals, medicines, and only that, and doesn't address the higher issues at the emotion or mental level. They may do a bit of counseling, but nothing more than that. So that is not holistic. It is just part of the approach, where a holistic physician will take the holistic approach, will look at the reason, where the block is, where the main issue is, and then help the patient. Also, one more thing that I want to tell you all about it, that we are not just the physical being, we are also the energy being. We all have this subtle energy field around us, which is very much there, though we cannot see it. It's where our emotions and our thoughts are there. So always remember, we are not just the physical being, we are also the energy being with our own energy field, where a lot of other information is there, and more I will tell you later about it. We have this dual existence. It's not that just because we can't see the energy field doesn't mean it's not there. It's pretty much there. Here is a very quick picture of showing you the subtle energy field that we human beings have, where there are several subtle bodies and there are also chakras and nadi points. Now, this is a totally subtle energy science, and this is part of the holistic health, and this is completely linked to our environment. This is not separate. It is linked to the earth, the planet, and the entire cosmos. And whatever is there in our body is in connection with our environment. There is a book that I read, fortunately, almost more than 30 years ago. And this book is called as The Vibrational Medicine. It is written by an American doctor, MD doctor, Dr. Richard Gerber. And he wrote this book. It is called as Vibrational Medicine. You can see my book picture, that it's really very old one. The book is still available. This is one book that talked a lot about subtle energy fields and various systems of healing and how it addresses. And he was also talking about how it has influence on the physical body. And you can call it as quantum healing. But this book is a very thick book, which has explained all about where the homeopathic medicines work, where the gem remedies work, where the flower remedies work. So here is the picture. I'll show you the close-up of this picture. The level of action of vibrational essences. So you can see that there are subtle bodies. There are homeopathic medicines which work up to acupuncture meridians and your etheric body. Then subtle to that is your astral body, where some of the gem elixirs, I will explain you what they are. They are remedies made from the gems. They work. And then finally, the flower remedies that I've been using for a long time, which are only healing energy of the flower, that work all the way to your deepest subtle body, which is mental and causal body. So the flower remedies have the deepest action in our energy body. So this is something very new information. I want everyone to pay attention, that why I use flower remedies, because they have very deep impact on our mind and emotions. Let's go on to the next slide. So as I mentioned before, that I am not just me, but I am also sum total of my environment. I am breathing the air. I am also in the company of people, and there are trees, there are birds, and there are human beings. They are all part of me. They are all part of me, and they are me. I cannot be just having a separate existence of who I am. I am always in constant inter-exchange with my environment. Interconnection, inter-exchange. We are in a dynamic universe and we are constantly exchanging. We can never be separate. So keep in mind that our environment has deep influence on who we are. The name of the book I will share right away. It is called as Vibration Medicine. You can Google it. The Dr. Richard Gerber. I'll just write down here itself so that you all can go and check out the book. The book was in second edition and you can find it. But Dr. Richard Gerber has almost no videos on internet. I checked and checked, but he has not come into the public life and any videos or nothing, no talk. But this is a foundational volume that has cleared all my understanding and made my foundation very strong. Now, the next concept that I want to tell you is about macrocosm and microcosm. In Sanskrit, they say that yatha brahmande tatha pinde, and yatha pinde tatha brahmande. What is in the human body is in the universe, and what is in the universe is also in the human body. We are the microcosm of the entire universe, which is macrocosm. That is why human beings are considered to be the supreme being on this planet that has everything represented from the entire universe. So this concept is very important later to understand about our disease and how we can help. We are very fortunate that we all have inner doctor in us. Although I am the doctor, I, you know, constantly remind everyone that we all have this inner doctor within us. And we all are better healed all the time, 24 hours, because this inner doctor is constantly working, constantly in action. Whenever we get a cut, within few days, it just heals. Who tells our body how to heal, when to stop blood, you know, and you know how the healthy bacteria should come and what healing should happen? All this is the work of this inner doctor, which is very intelligent, which is working all the time. And we all need to learn to trust this inner doctor. It is very, very important that we connect to this inner doctor, remain aware, and do not want to outsource so much. Start trusting, start listening to our body, and make friendship with this inner doctor. This is the famous book that Louise Hay wrote many years ago, but that time she was already in her 60s. And the name of this book is You Can Heal Your Life. Louise Hay suffered from cervical cancer, and how she recovered completely through the power of positive thinking and affirmation. And this is one single book that changed the life, you know, of millions across the globe. And this is one of the books that I strongly recommend, that she opened up the world and, you know, inspired people to start thinking that there's something more than just the physical body. It's also your mind, if your emotions, they're completely linked. Nothing happens by chance. And that is exactly what I have observed when I was, you know, talking to my cancer patients. Cancer did not happen just like that. There was something also at the mind and emotions. Now, once the diagnosis is established and my patients come to me with the diagnosis, there's one question I always ask. As I see a very vacant look in their eye, and they are very dissipated or shocked or are thinking, you know, about their disease. So one question I ask, do you want to live, or there's something within you that just is calling you to just leave this planet and go, just die. My work is done, or I'm done with this world and I want to go. Often I feel, you know, the cancer develops sometimes on the way when a patient gives up. There's a subtle desire to die or want to wind up, or I'm done with it, or has gone through a lot of trauma in life and doesn't want to live anymore. There's something that he's, you know, hiding or keeping inside and just wants to wind up. So I ask this question without fear. I remember one patient, he had a small tumor on his abdomen skin, and it was just a very small one, and it was removed, and it was just a very beginning stage of cancer. And the doctors thought it was, you know, nothing to worry. Just gave him a little bit of radiotherapy sessions and no chemo, nothing. So surgery, radiation, and he said, fine, go. The patient used to come to me for some other reasons, and somehow I used to talk to the patient, and then I came to know that later on he developed the secondaries in the liver. Such a small tumor that was already removed, radiation was already done, but the secondaries came in liver. And I asked him, what is it that you are, you know, hiding? What is the story of your life? And then he started crying. He had very deep trauma, and he was still in his early 60s. It was not the age to go, but like a lot of bitterness in his life, resentment. And he just said, I just, you know, can't overcome it. I can't forgive, and I just want to die. So I just gave him a hug and let him cry, held his hand, and I said, whatever is your decision is final. If you want to leave, that I will help you. If you want to make the transition, I will still help you to make the transition better. So this is the one of the hardest lessons that I have learned as a doctor, to let go of my patient into the other realm if they have decided, if they want to wind up, and then the cancer just happened to be there developing. So I do not want to interfere the process. As when I was a young doctor, I wanted all my patients to leave, and I would desperately try very hard, and I keep doing. But now I learned, as I've become wiser, I'm 60 now, I allow this space, I allow this decision, and I said, I will assist you either way. If you want to leave, fine, I'll help you all the way. If you want to wind up and go, I'll still help you. And I will not take that as a personal failure, and I'll hold your hand and, you know, help you heal even that. So I do not see death as an end. It is only a change and a transformation, and it's also a healing of another kind. And I will assist you over there. So friends, this is a very completely new concept as a doctor that I have taken on. And I assist my patient as a part of healing, even in this process. Then the question comes, whether should I get the biopsy done or not? So the mainstream medicine doctors will say that get the biopsy done, because that's the way we know whether it is cancer or not. And once the diagnosis is established, we can do more things with you. So that is the mainstream. I do not oppose this. Let the patient make the informed choice. If he wants to, that is also fine. If he doesn't want to, that also is fine, because it's the patient's right to choose the best path in his life. He can do it. So I leave the decision back to the patient for taking the complete responsibility. Once the diagnosis is confirmed, of course, there is shock, there is panic, there are fears, there's denial, there's numbness, there is complete bereavement, and you know, there's like a very vacant look, or death is staring. So this is the time where, you know, there's a blank out situation, just don't know how to move or what to do. And this is the time also the counseling is very, very important. And this is where we do a very gentle hand holding. There is also this question that they ask, why me? There are no mistakes in nature, unfortunately. Nature is a very perfect computer. Everything happens on time. Sometimes the cancer happens at a stage in life when it's like a ticking program. You know, 30, 40 years of life went well, and suddenly there's a trigger and this happens. So why me? Why me? Everything was so well in life. Why me? But how about say, try me and let me look at it. This is another way of looking at the disease that we get. So instead of why me, there is also try me, and maybe because I can handle it, I am the chosen one. So I see disease as a friend. That's been my way of looking at every disease. I may get the strongest of the diagnosis with the patients, but I will say that disease is our friend. For For years and years, I've been telling my patients that every disease comes with a lesson to learn. Unless we learn the lesson, the disease does not go away and it returns in some other form. And love is the greatest healing force. And our message is always to heal is to love. So disease to be seen as our friend. There is a beautiful book written in anthroposophic medicine. It is called as Blessed by Illness. I'll just write down the name of the book, Blessed by Illness. These are the books that changed my perception about disease. And I learned so much over the years. And that is the book that tells that when you get a particular disease, it is life-changing, transforming, and it is, you know, changing the path of your life. You are blessed by illness because you learn so many new things. Now, the next stage that we come into, decision, which way to go. You will have everyone giving you advice. And there are like probably 40, 50 different advices coming almost every single day. Which doctor to go to, which hospital, what are the credentials of the doctor. Go on to the Google Guruji and find out all about your disease, then about the various stages, various investigations, and then also alternative systems of medicine. So many different advices come. Some miracle drugs, some miracle oil, some miracle herb. All this also comes, and you know, you are like exhausted. Next one whole week, you're constantly thinking, what do I do? Do I do this? Should I go natural way? Should I do? This is the very hard time. Then all the different treatment options, then the round of various doctors and taking the advice, and it's really very, very tough. And you know, you get confused, you get depressed. You're already depressed by looking at your loved ones or your own self, and to take decision is very, very hard, and I fully understand. Then there is pressure from the society. It's not just the society, also from your dear ones. In the family itself, people are divided. Some wants to do radiation, chemo, as suggested. Some wants to do natural. Some wants to do some remote healing. It is so hard. And there's so much pressure from the society. What if your heart says, I want to do only natural? Immediately, someone dear, you know, will come and say, Mar jaogi, maar daalogi kya patient ko? What are you doing? Just, you know, do the main thing. Forget about all this thing. And then you keep quiet. Oh my goodness. So this is very hard time, very, very difficult. You have to do what the mainstream protocol is. And then there is all these other things that are coming. You're already emotionally very depressed and very spaced out, very, very hard. And you're constantly searching for a miracle cure somewhere. The allopathic approach is like a war on cancer. They see cancer cells as enemy, and that entire system is driven towards killing the cancer cells rather than looking at the cause why the cancer cells are happening in the first place. It's not random. The DNA of your body cells do not change overnight. There's always constant stressor, and then it, you know, one day decides to change. So it's a process, you know. There is another book that I would like to mention to everyone, by written by Dr. Bruce Lipton. Have you all heard about Dr. Bruce Lipton? It is called as Biology of Belief. Biology of Belief. It is absolutely worth reading this book. Very, very beautiful book. Here, Dr. Lipton, PhD, is clearly mentioning about, he talks about genes, and he talks about epigenetics, and he talks about what is epigenes. It's not just the genetics, but it is the epigenetics. Epigenetics means around the genes, our environmental factors that changes our genes in the cells. And he talks about changing the environment. So this is the book, Biology of Belief, worth reading it. And so allopathic system does not pay attention to the environment, whereas Dr. Lipton clearly mentions that environment is the one which is feeding and which is creating the trigger into your cells to become cancer cells. Now, of course, if you have already decided to go through surgery, radiation, chemotherapy. I honor my patient. If they want to, if it is their choice, please go ahead. I will assist you there also. Because I don't want to discourage anyone. It is an integrated approach. Take what is chosen by you, and I will support you all along. So to reduce the side effects of surgery, of radiotherapy or chemotherapy, I use natural means. And that also is very suitable to many of our patients, and they love the idea that they are getting also the allopathic treatment, the best of it, and then they are also doing this natural support. And the both things, work together, and we gradually rebuild their body, mind and emotions. So that is the holistic approach. I try to help them to reduce their chemotherapy side effects, and also same in the radiation when there are burns on the skin. So then I want to help them to, heal these burns very beautifully. So, they are, healed very fast, and they can come out of their condition very fast. So this is how, this is called as integrated approach. While they're already doing all these things, we are constantly supporting with the natural remedies. And there are no side effects, there are no untoward effects, and you can recover very fast. I've had patients who had almost very little or no reactions to chemotherapy, then also radiotherapy healed very beautifully. So I know, and I can tell from my personal experience, that this is really nice. Also, remember that integrated approach has a lot of gentleness and compassionate approach. We treat human beings. We don't treat diseases. We treat human beings. We look the person as a whole. It's a very human approach. We are, talking about handling them very, very gently. So just give me a moment. I'll be all right, I'm back. I'm sorry for the short break. So it's a very, very gentle approach. You are, you are talking to a very fragile soul who is not just broken in body, but also broken in emotions, and also, in the soul, very, into pieces, overwhelmed. And here you want to be very, very gentle, very caring, and very soft to them, and holding their hands and helping them heal gently and beautifully. It's a very, very compassionate approach. So I always say that we are complementary to the allopathic medicine. I am not against allopathic medicine ever. I will never say like that. I will just say that we are complementary to allopathic, and I would like to move on in life and not have any fights or anything against any systems of medicine. The one thing that I constantly inspire all my patients is about taking on the plant-based diet. Nowadays, I get lots of patients, once the diagnosis is already established, they come and take my advice on the plant-based diet. And I definitely give it to them. The foundation of this is a book called as The China Study by Dr. T. Colin Campbell. So I'll write down the name here if any of you want to read this book. This is the book that talks a lot about cancer patients and how the plant-based diet is the most suitable diet for the cancer patients. So the name of the book is China Study, and I inspire all my patients to go on a plant-based diet. The reasons, I don't want to go into details about what's wrong with the meat, dairy, fish or eggs, which you can read in this book, but this is something that I inspire, I insist, and it's definitely very, very beneficial to go on this. The nature cure principles I use are based on five elements, and each element have to be strengthened, as our body is also made up of the five elements. And those principles are taken into consideration, and then we balance out what is within and what is without. So if there's less sunshine in your life, take the sunshine. if there is less water in your life, let's take the water. So various ways we use these five elements. So earlier I had mentioned about macrocosm and microcosm. It's exactly the same balancing of the five elements inside the body with the balancing of the five elements outside. And if we remain in harmony, if these elements are in harmony, the health will return very quickly. So that is the nature cure principles. One of the best speaker of this is Dr. Arun Sharma. And his grandfather wrote the book Nature Cure by Lakshman Sharma. Then the role of negative emotions. So over the years, it's not just the body where the toxins are, there are also emotional toxins. There is bitterness, there is, in my language, I'm Gujarati, we say there is some, you know, knot in the mind. The knot in the mind is also knot in the body. The tumor in the mind is tumor in the body. All these unresolved emotions, all these experiences which are not digested, which are locked up somewhere in your memory, in your emotions, like the baggage, they all work towards, you know, finally converting into tumor. You have deep-seated fears. You are going through some sadness, some shock, some experiences, some abuse, some childhood abuse, some sexual abuse. All these things, you know, are pretty much in the system, though we might have forgotten. If they are pretty much there, they are like the programs, they are ticking, the time is ticking away, and they will get activated at the appropriate time, and then the disease will happen. The cancer, breast cancer, the uterine cancer, cervical cancer, very clear, interpersonal relationship, shocks, trauma, and then this happens. So which part of the body? Liver, cancer, anger, suppressed anger, stomach, sadness and shock, lungs, grief, all these emotions and various organs are very linked, and the disease happens according to what negative emotions we harbor in our system. And when the time comes, then this, you know, converts into the tumor cells. So just the way we clean up our physical body, we also have to clean up our emotional body of all these negative emotions. And that's quite a job. And that's what something I do very regularly with all my patients. One of the most important lessons that I learned is about forgiveness. And in forgiveness also, there is something more. We call it as radical forgiveness or true forgiveness. And this is an advanced technique of forgiveness that I take sessions with. I sit with my patient and I explain them of the difference between just the forgiveness and the deep-seated radical forgiveness. And when that happens, there's a very big transformation at the emotional level, and there are good chances of healing very fast. The Indian flower remedies that we have been making, my husband, Dr. Atul, and myself, we have been making remedies from our Indian flowers. This is not the platform to tell more about it, but I'll just say that we don't cut any flowers. We do not destroy any flowers. We only take the healing energy of flower in water, and this water is used as remedy. So I will be doing some flower remedy basic courses very soon. I will announce about it in some time and you all can attend. And these are extremely profound, very powerful flower remedies that I use. They work very deep into our mind and emotions and heal them completely. And very gently, very beautifully, and does not make you dependent on any of these remedies. So this is something that I've been using it for years and years for cancer patients. Also, I always recommend about yoga and other exercises. Those are always going to help. And include them in your life. Pranayama is also very, very helpful. Also, the power of prayer and meditation. If you do not know how to, I do teach them. I want my patients to connect to the divine element within. Whatever they can name it as their deity or the God or whatever, or their own soul, but do connect and have very deep faith in the power of healing of your own soul. what if the patient is going to die? Sometimes they come too late, like maybe last few weeks are left, last few days are left sometimes. So then I give them very good advice that let us improve the last few days of that person and let's make it very comfortable. Let's not, you know, have the fear around, you know, our mind constantly, you know, having the death and loss. Let's not see it like that. It is living of the physical body, but the soul, you know, is going to go onward journey and there's nothing to worry about it. And let's just be very gentle, talk to the patient, make him aware. There are very good patients that I have talked to. They do not want to be tied to the machines. They will tell me clearly, please do not insert tubes on my body. Please do not put me on ventilator. Please do not prolong my death. Please do not make me, you know, go through the torture. Please let me die on my favorite bed. Many years ago, an uncle of mine who was a chronic smoker suffered from lung cancer. The lung cancer, when was detected, was far advanced, but he was very fortunate at that time. That was about 25 years ago. He met a very good oncologist who told him that let's not do anything. Your time has come. Maybe it's time to go. And you just do not take any, you know, harsh treatment. Go home, stay with your family, spend your rest of the time and just keep one oxygen cylinder at home and nothing else. And that's about exactly what he did. And everyone he met, he made peace with everyone, asked for forgiveness, and he peacefully, you know, made the transition. So this is what I would like to say. Let's not be scared of death. Death is part of life. Let's make also death very peaceful, comfortable, beautiful. I always like to create a beautiful environment around the person who is dying. Very peaceful, quiet, prayers, love, and dear ones and their favorite bed, and, you know, let them, you know, breathe their last. This is something I have been always honoring, and let's not get into the panic of wanting to do something or, you know, take them into the hospitals. Unfortunately, we live in the society where even birth happens in the hospital and even the death happens in hospital in many cases. I would like to inspire that let's not be afraid and, you know, accept death and, you know, honor it beautifully. I have lots of people. I met lots of people who have reversed their cancer. Anisha Koiri is one of them who reversed her breast cancer. Meghna Shukla, who used millets. Anisha used Nature Cure and many other systems, but no allopathy. Ratnakar Vichare had done everything and yet then finally went onto the raw vegan diet and reversed his cancer. Mona reversed her breast cancer. She also used allopathic and raw and plant-based diet. And Anju reversed her breast cancer. She also took allopathic, but the plant-based diet and the, you know, the tumors in the liver regressed very quickly. And she then went on to do some more allopathic and recovered completely. And there are many such stories that I can say. So there is no one approach for everyone. Each patient can decide what he wants to do as per his vitality and his situation and condition. Remember, that is the best way. Let's not bombard. Let's not overdose. Let's just be very gentle in our approach. So just a little bit of quick summary of what I would like to do with my patients is get them onto whole food, plant-based diet. Inspire them to take more raw and living foods. If possible, do detox enema or take Tona, which is the toning up of your large intestine. Fasting as per the capacity, if possible, acupuncture, acupressure, energy massage or regular massage, if possible, energy healing, if possible, like pranic healing or Reiki sessions. Then sunlight, absolutely important. Yoga and meditation, I already mentioned. The positive attitude, forgiveness, and I also teach joyful mind magic techniques and emotional freedom techniques and also the natural flower remedies that I already also mentioned to you. This is some total of what I usually do with my patients as part of the integrated approach. If they choose to take allopathy, that is all fine. I support them all along. I am also not worried that, you know, allopathic or other treatment therapies will destroy the patient's body or something like that, because I have huge faith in all these other therapies that I do that has tremendous power and will heal the body completely and support it all along. The cancer prevention, if you have many cancer patients in your body, is pretty much same as the cancer treatment. There is no change. All the steps are same. Go on to the plant-based diet. That's one of the step number one. Some of the books that I would like to quickly mention are this Andreas Mori's Cancer is Not a Disease. It's available on internet. You can probably also get a PDF version of it. Another, this is Anita Murjani. She was in the last stage of cancer. She was in coma and just only few hours left when suddenly she just went out of her body and learned some of the most important lessons about her disease and what happens after death. And then she chose to leave and come back and heal herself completely of her disease, as she understood the reasons why she had developed her disease. And then she recovered beautifully, completely within no time. And then she wrote this book, Dying to Be Me. And this is a very beautiful, very, very inspiring book by Anita Murjani. She has lots of wonderful videos. Do watch and inspire yourself. This is the book that I read 37 years ago when I had gone to America. And Dr. Bernie Siegel is a regular surgeon, cancer surgeon. And while he operated many of his patients, he came to know that some patients survived and some patients did not survive. So he tried to study why some patients survived, what was so unique about them. And he called them as exceptional cancer patients, ECAP. At that time, there were no other pathies or nothing. He was a regular MD doing his allopathic, radio, chemo, everything. And yet he saw some patients survive. And he studied them, the ECAP, the exceptional cancer patient. And then he wrote this book. And he said that beyond that, it is the attitude of the patient. It is the tremendous willpower and wanting to survive and work, you know, their way out that, you know, healed them. So I have been very inspired by this book. He wrote series of more books. And probably there are videos also of Dr. Bernie Siegel. This is the book I already mentioned, China Study. That is on a plant-based diet. It is one of the most profound volume about the plant-based diet. There is another website which is called as Truth About Cancer. This is by Ty and Charlene Bollinger. I have listened to all their videos, and he has interviewed the best of the cancer specialists across the globe who also offer this integrated approach, or we call it as complementary or alternative approach. And it's very, very educating. And because his many members of his family died of cancer, he thought, I need to learn something about it. And he went on to this journey and produced this entire video series. And his website has also a lot of interesting articles. And he has interviewed many cancer patients who chose another path and how they healed themselves. So I would like to now almost end my talk today. And these are my websites. I regularly conduct workshops, webinars, courses, and I also do consultations and offer various support plans. I'm also on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, and Telegram. My email is drrupasha@gmail.com. My website is drrupasha.com. And there are also other websites that I support and inspire. And there's also a flower remedy website that you can see. Charu Mathur is asking me, can you talk a little bit more about Mind Magic by the Russians? Sure, I will do it right away, Charu. This is the time for question and answer. And I'll stop sharing my slides so that we can all now see me, and then I will answer. So Joyful Mind Magic Technique. There is not much information on internet about it. I came across a book it is called as Art of Soaring by this Russian author. Name is Dolokhov, and he and his partner, they wrote this book, and the book got luckily translated from Russian to English, and the book sold 1 million copy in Russia. And then I just happened to be in Florida in a doctor's clinic, meeting him and chatting, and a staff member came and gave me this book. Have a book, you know, this book is very good, read it. So since I was traveling and I thought in my, you know, flight I should be able to read it, I picked up that book. And then the second book was The Power of Luck. There were the two books written by this Russian magicians. They teach this joyful mind magic technique, which is completely out of this world, which takes time to understand. The book is not easy to understand, but I read through and kept practicing those techniques, and I teach these techniques to those who are willing to learn, which is completely out of box. It's a joyful mind magic. And so I teach this. There are various steps, and if you all want to learn, there is a free video on my YouTube channel, which is Healing Temple. You can see the first video over there, and there are a couple of more videos which you also can see are on our Vimeo platform. So if you want to see, just send us an email and we'll share those free videos. Have a look at it. And in future, I'll be doing more workshops. They are completely magical. They tell you that you are responsible for your own life. You create your own world and you are the magician. The whole thing about holistic approach is not outsourcing your medical needs to something outside. You take charge of your own body. You decide to heal yourself. You become responsible for your diet, for your lifestyle, for your emotions, and then get going. This is what exactly it is. So this is what I inspire, joyful mind magic, Charu. There are some very good stories in that book also about health problems, you know, getting solved. Also the money problems getting solved, or some relationship problems. So this joyful mind magic can be applied to various aspects of our life. This is completely now out of the box, not for this particular session where we are just talking about integrated approach. But if my patient is ready, I do a session and I explain and I teach them to create a new world. So I create my own world. I am responsible for my life. And if I choose, I can create another world. So if you just choose to be healthy, you can be. And you can, you know, start your journey that way as well. If there are any other questions, I'm happy to answer right name. Oh, the name of the book, Priya, is Art of Soaring. I'm writing it down over here. And the one of the author I'm writing so that you find the book. If you don't, then please do ask us. We will definitely be happy to share. The book is available on internet, on amazon.com, not in India, but they will send it to you from there, and it's about probably 2,500. But as I said, since it is translated from Russian to English, it's not very easy to understand. It's the language, it takes time, and someone who's gone through a journey, that person can understand very well and apply it in life. Any interest, Deepika, you're interested in flower remedies, I will surely do it. It's a beautiful journey that I have over the 37 years in the company of nature. Learned so much about flowers and healing power of flowers, and every flower is so beautiful, helping us in the mind and emotions. And since we are not separate from the body as well, all of it get healed and has a very deep healing power in the flowers. Hufresh wants to know more about the course on flower remedies. Sure, we will definitely share it with you. We are also on Instagram. I will announce it over there if you can share it. And also people ask me the questions, what all different things you can treat with flower remedies. So I say practically everything, you know, you can try your hand on. You can try for memory problems, lack of confidence, fearfulness and nervousness, stress and tension, depression, negative thoughts, anxiety, immune system, cleansing remedy, fasting assistance, menopause, all kinds, you know. So it'd be wonderful to know all about it. Anyone else? Any questions? I'm just kind of scrolling through. I don't have ebook, you know, NP of any of this. If you love to search it on the internet, but the vibrational medicine book is something that I, as a doctor, would love to teach all those health coaches and natural doctors who are, you know, willing to learn, because there's a lot more to learn there, a lot more. And there's not much awareness about it, so I would like to definitely, you know, share my knowledge over the years. Also, one of the interesting things that I would like to say that though I'm an allopathic doctor, in last 37 years, I personally had to hardly take any allopathic medicine. Mostly, I found something in nature, something in flower remedy to help myself. It's not that I was all healthy, right? I was not born healthy. As the years went by, due to my lifestyle mistakes, due to some emotional and mental issues, and something that I learned in my life, I had to, you know, heal myself. So the flower remedies helped me, the plant-based diet helped me, following the principles of nature helped me, and now I'm 60, and each year, I am more healthy than the previous year. I have more energy in my body than the previous year. I look much younger than my age, and I have so much more energy than when I was probably 24. So my aim is to remain very healthy till the end of my life, 100 maybe, 100, my eyes, ears, nose, everything intact. And I want to prove the point that you can choose to be healthy, you can be charge of your life, and you can live that life. So at 60, I haven't got any of the diseases that my friends or my colleagues, and they all have it already or are on some medication, I don't have, because I have learned the way, and I am very happy to teach you all. Yes, my flower remedy fridge course will be very soon, maybe in 2 weeks itself I'll be announcing. I'm working out the details, and I will share the note with everyone, then you all can join. So I any other questions? Otherwise it's 1 hour 15 minutes. I may keep it on for another few more minutes if you all have any questions or anything that you all want to know. Anyone want to ask me any questions? Thank you for being here, Yogesh and Priya, and also Dr. More, thank you very much. Deepika, thank you. Harendra, also thank you. And Shobha Desai, thank you very much for always attending my talks and cheering me up. Jasmina, also thank you very much. Vaishnavi, yes, absolutely. The most important thing is a doctor should have is called as art of listening. Art of listening, a doctor should practice this art of listening. His patient is telling him something, be gentle, be good, listen, connect to his heart, connect to his soul, and listen to the story of his life. We can learn a lot from there, and then start holding their hand and gently carry them through the life's journey. It could be living, or it may be, you know, making the transition and going to the other plane. Both are okay, both we can hold their hands. This is my message, is to unconditional love for our patient heals them beautifully. Thank you very much. And anyone who wants to take the know about the recording of this session, we will share it a bit later. Some of you wanted to talk to me. I'll see if I can get you live. I have to accept you, but in that case, Samir, we may have to exit from the one window and keep it empty. If you can leave from this, Samir, and then only I can invite the other people. Can you get, thank you very much. So now I will invite Priya, Dr. More, Rita Bhausar, if you all are still here, and if you want to come, please, I have sent you invitation, I have accepted you, and if you get the notification, please come on the screen and I will chat with you since I have some more time left. I will share the name of the books if you all want in a separate email. And those books are life-changing. They have changed my life. I have over the years more cupboards for my books than my clothes. And those are my cherished friends, and they have changed, and they are my masters as well. I've learned a lot from them. So Sujal Sabnis, is it true that avoiding sugar can cure or avoid cancer, as well as fasting or having only 2 meals? So Sujal, it's a total approach. So just because you leave sugar doesn't mean that you will get cured or something. Sugar is one aspect of it. There can be fasting. If the patient has strength and is possibility, we can gently guide them how the fasting can help them. Definitely fasting is definitely good. Then some raw elements, some cooked elements, yes, those. So it's a holistic approach. So I will definitely say that all these are helpful and we will incorporate them. Hufrish is asking how to gradually avoid jaggery from our diet. Correct. The jaggery, you know, there are fruits which are sweet. So I have seen that there's apple powder available, dry apple powder, and that is sweet also. So if you add that in your food, then you get natural sweetness. You can take grapes, raisins, you can take apricots, and you add any of these dates also, then you can, you know, get rid of jaggery and sugar both, whatever you want. White sugar, definitely. Sometimes we just use sugar cane juice also directly. Anyone else who wants to ask me any questions? I did accept your request for speak, and if you have found, just have a look, invitation, then come. Here I am going to start a poll, and if any of you want to answer, please do answer. It's on the screen. Please do answer. We have to be responsible for our own health. How many of you agree and not agree? The cancer patients should not use jaggery also. If possible, just use sweet fruits. White sugar is 100% no, Shobha. White sugar, definitely they must stop right away. This is creating a very toxic environment. Definitely. All right, 100% of you are already agreeing that, you know, we are responsible for our own health. Wonderful. Thank you very much for taking part. Let me take one more poll, just a quick one, and see if you all can answer. I am very happy to know. Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Let me have a look. Thank you very much for your answer. So I like to now, Harendra ji, you are asking me, yes, as soon as very consulting, helpful. All right. So I probably don't understand the sentence, but you're most welcome to contact me. My WhatsApp number I'm writing here. If you want to take it down, or also my email, I'm writing it here. You can send me an email and we will take it from there. There are no absolute suggestions. We have to take it from case to case, depending on each person, their capacity, their situation, the age, the which condition the cancer is in, everything, and then gently do the hand holding. All right, thank you very much, friends. I think I would like to take a no more polls, nothing. Thank you very much for taking out time today and attending this live session. And in future also, I'll be talking on various webinars on various topics like PCOD, obesity, thyroid. All this we will do one by one, and we will announce. Since you've given us your email address, and your cell number, we will try to send you email. Keep checking, and you will be informed about it. Most likely the next one would be Joyful Mind Magic for those who are interested in money and all money matters. And the next one will be on the flower remedies, Indian flower remedies. It will be a basic course, just like an introduction, and you should be able to learn that, you know. All right, thank you very much. Thank you, Priya. Thank you, Sujal. That's the end of it. Namaste.